Welcome back to Part B of Topic 7 lecture. This is where we will discuss the last two learning objectives, 5 and 6. In Learning Objective 5, we will explain how and why managers cater to Wall Street using their accounting discretion. We have seen in Part A lecture that there is a huge incentive for managers to tie their accounting numbers with what the expectations of the EPS, for example, are, because that's related to their bonuses. Now, we will see from Learning Objective 5 that really there is the pressure for managers, the top executives in particular, to actually meet what is expected by the market in terms of the stock prices, and that has to do with the Wall Street. So although there are some protection against short-term focus, the main problem is the prevalence of these stock options or stock ownership, despite the fact that there are compensation committees that to a certain extent control the compensation of the top executives. So here, let us have a look at this quote about catering to Wall Street. It says here, many companies at one time or another massage their numbers using creative accounting techniques and probably do it now more than ever. The issue isn't so much whether many companies are committing fraud. That's likely confined to a small group of dishonest executives. But for most companies, it isn't even a matter of stretching the rules to wildly inflate their results. It's more a question of how many companies following standard accounting guidelines use loopholes to tweak their earnings number here and there just to make the crucial number earnings per share look better. This is according to Kay Brown. Tweaking results is hardly a sometime thing. So the prevalence of stock options in the executive pay packages may actually contribute rather than moderate this short-term focus of managers. EPS makes a lot of difference to investors, even if it's just 1 cent. Just watch what happens to a company's share price when the quarterly EPS comes in 1 or 2 cents below what the analysts' expectations are. Therefore, the critics argue that the stock options included in the compensation package for managers really encourage the management to cater to Wall Street's short-term earnings expectations. And managers appear to do so. The actual EPS numbers do not fall randomly around the analyst consensus. You know, it doesn't happen by chance. Too many firms report EPS numbers that just meet or beat the estimate, while there are too few that report EPS that falls just short of the estimate. There's one commentator who said, managements try to give investors what they want, and companies whose earnings are predictable are priced on Wall Street, which does not like unhappy surprises. There was a survey conducted among 400 financial executives of US companies. When the executives were asked, why is it important to meet the earnings benchmark? An overwhelming 86% of the respondents said, it helps build credibility with the capital market. More than 80% agreed that meeting benchmarks help to maintain or increase the firm's stock price. And so here, the majority of the respondents believe that meeting the earnings benchmarks enhances their external reputations. And so this conveys favorable information about the future growth prospects and reduces stock price volatility. So what's at the top of their concern? It's really to maintain external excellent reputation. So the question is, how do firms meet their earnings benchmarks? Well, the answer is, for many companies, that means they have operational excellence, they provide customers with highly valuable products and services, and they control their costs and attend to a lot of business details. But what if it looks like the company will fall short of the desired earnings target? That's when managers are tempted. Here comes the temptation. That's when managers are tempted to take real actions to maintain the accounting appearances. And many of these actions can be costly to shareholders because it masks the underlying fundamentals of the operations of the business. So in the same survey that we were talking about, it says nearly 80% of the financial executives surveyed would decrease their discretionary spending on items like research, advertising, and the like in order to meet the earnings target. And some said they would do only maintenance that is minimal in order to hit benchmarks, even if it meant that the equipment would wear out more quickly. And many actually admitted they would postpone a new project even if it meant sacrificing long-term firm value. So in this regard, we can say that this catering to Wall Street provides a huge motivation for managers to focus on the short term rather than the long term. And this is a classic example of agency cost that is being borne by the shareholders, the principal of these agents, the agents being the top executives. It is important to note, though, that accounting actions that are taken to hit earnings target actually violate GAAP and US securities laws if the resulting financial statements misrepresent the firm's performance and condition. Now, let me introduce you to these regulation accounting principles. Financial statements that are used by creditors and shareholders are, as we know, prepared under GAAP rules. Now, there are certain industries such as banks, insurance companies, public utilities, and others that must provide financial statements to the government agencies. And these government agencies that regulate these industries have a different set of accounting principles known as regulatory accounting principles. So let us have a look at this RAP, Regulatory Accounting Principles, applies to specific industries such as banks, insurance companies, and public utilities. GAAP are for retailers, manufacturers, and all the other non-regulated industries. So the question is, are RAP and GAAPs the same or are they different? Well, RAP refers to the accounting methods and procedures that must be followed to satisfy requirements of government agencies that regulate companies in these certain industries. And RAP accounting sometimes differs from GAAP accounting. So RAP sometimes affects the company's GAAP financial statements. Therefore, knowing how a company accounts for its business transactions, whether it's under GAAP or RAP, is essential to gaining a clear understanding of the company's financial performance. Let us have a look at specific capital requirements in the banking industry. So, to ensure that institutions remain financially sound and can meet its obligations to depositors, banks are required to meet the minimum capital requirements, for example, 10%. So there is this capital adequacy ratio that must be met. And this is simply the investor capital as defined by RAP divided by the gross assets, again, as defined by RAP. So for example, if the minimum capital adequacy ratio is 10% and a company that has 135 million of investor capital has gross assets of $900 million, then that means it met the minimum capital requirements because this company has 15%. So if bank capital falls below the required level, regulatory intervention can be triggered. To avoid these regulatory compliance costs, banks can, of course, operate profitably and invest wisely so that the bank remains financially sound. They could choose accounting policies that increase RAP, invested capital, or decrease RAP, gross assets, so that the bank can pass this capital adequacy test. Regulators have a powerful weapon to encourage compliance with minimum capital guidelines. They can impose costs on banks and financial institutions found to be non-compliant. So, for example, a non-complying bank is required to submit a comprehensive plan describing how and when its capital will be increased. They can be examined more frequently by the regulator. They can be denied a request to merge or open new branches or even expand services. And they can be prohibited from paying dividends. Let's look at another industry that is under RAP, the electricity utilities industry. Now, public utility commissions set the prices that utilities may charge. So it's not the utility companies that set the prices. It's the public utility commissions. The rate formulas use accounting determined costs and assets values. RAP gets included in the GAAP financial statements that utility companies prepare for the shareholders and creditors. So here is the rate formula. It sets the total allowed revenue equal to an amount that covers the company's operating costs and provides a fair return on the capital investment in operating assets. So the allowed revenue is calculated as operating costs plus depreciation plus taxes plus the ROA times the asset base. So the allowed revenue will determine the rates the customers will be charged. And the ROA is the return on assets allowed by the regulator. So for example, an electricity company sets the rate charge per kilowatt hour as follows. Rate is equal to the allowed revenue, and then it will be divided by the estimated total kilowatt hours. So there are different rates that are typically charged to different types of customers. So for example, the commercial customers and the residential customers might be charged differently. Now, rate regulation creates incentives for public utility managers to increase the reported asset base. So here is an example. Let's suppose that an electric utility company signs a $700,000 one-year rental agreement for service vehicles. If the rental payment is an allowed operating cost for rate-making purposes, then customers would pay $700,000 in the form of higher electricity rates. In contrast, if the rental is included in the company's regulatory asset base, then the customers would pay more because that asset base, as shown in the allowed revenue formula, is multiplied by the return on asset, the ROA. So if, let's say, the ROA allowed is 10%, then with the $700,000 rental agreement for service vehicles, it will be capitalized as part of asset base, and another 10%, so 10% times the asset base of $700,000 will add another $70,000 to the rate charged to the customers. So given this choice, the utility company would prefer to have the rental payment treated as an asset for rate making purposes. So one way of making this happen, that extra 70,000, is to design a rental contract so that it qualifies for wrap treatment as an asset. That's one way. Another approach is to lobby the regulators to relax the rules governing when a rental contract qualifies for asset treatment. So as you can see here, the two options to either change the contract so that it will qualify as the part of the asset, or to lobby for the regulators to change the accounting rules. Either way, it will achieve the same result. It will add more to the asset base, which therefore increase the allowed revenue stream for the rate regulated company. Let's move on to taxation. Now, the rules set by the Internal Revenue Code, the IRC, and the Internal Revenue Service, IRS regulations, as well as court cases that govern the determination of income for tax purposes, are another form of RAPs. Many tax accounting rules are the same as GAAP rules. There are situations where tax rules differ from GAAP, however. So GAAP depreciation expense is one example. GAAP depreciation expense will rarely, if ever, equal to the tax depreciation, because tax rules require companies to use the modified accelerated cost recovery system to determine depreciation for tax purposes. U.S. firms are not required to use the same accounting methods for their financial statements and on their tax returns, except that if LIFO is used on the tax return, the LIFO conformity rule requires LIFO to be used in the GAAP financial statements. So that is the exception. If the company uses LIFO for tax purposes, then it must be used also for financial reporting purposes. But in terms of depreciation, no. You could use depreciation methods such as straight line or unit of productions method for accounting purposes, and yet you're allowed a modified accelerated cost recovery system of depreciation for tax purposes. Recall that I have introduced you to the Dodd-Frank Act earlier. So another aspect of the Dodd-Frank Act mandated new disclosures in SEC filings aimed at addressing broader social issues, including mine safety and conflict minerals. So mining industry is another industry that has a special disclosure requirement. Let's look at the mine safety. The mine safety disclosures were motivated by concerns that mine worker safety in the United States was insufficient. The second one is on conflict minerals disclosures. Now, this requires registrants that use tantalum, tin, gold, or tungsten in their manufacturing process to conduct a country of origin inquiry to determine if any of these minerals, tantalum, tin, gold, are originating from Democratic Republic of Congo or a neighboring country. Now, you might ask why the need to disclose where did these minerals come from. Well, the conflict minerals disclosures were motivated by concerns that the purchases of these minerals by Western companies from the Democratic Republic of Congo are fueling a conflict that has left more than 10 million people dead. So, in 2012, the SEC adopted rules to implement the conflict minerals disclosures that requires all those companies that use tin, gold, tantalum, and tungsten to actually disclose one of the following. First one, that it is conflict-free, meaning the minerals did not originate in a covered country or they did originate in a covered country but did not finance or benefit armed groups. So the company must have its conflicts minerals report audited and disclose the name of the auditor. So this is to prevent companies from buying these minerals from Democratic Republic of Congo or any neighboring countries that are involved in this conflict. If they are not reporting that the mineral is conflict-free, then the company must disclose that it has not been found to be conflict-free, in which case the company must, in addition to providing the name of the auditor of the conflict minerals report, they must also disclose the products that have not been found to be conflict-free, as well as the facilities used to process the conflict minerals in those products, the country of origin of the conflict minerals in those products, and the efforts to determine the mine or the location of origin with the greatest possible specifics. So this is to prohibit companies from buying minerals that are originating from those conflict areas. All right, let's now move to the last learning objective, and that is to discuss the importance of fair value accounting and how it relates to the financial crisis. So fair value accounting is the practice of continually revaluing an asset or liability to the price it would bring if sold or the cost to settle, regardless of what was actually paid for the asset or received for the liability. Now, banks and other financial services were overall content with the fair value rules when markets were going up. But what happened in 2008 when we have the global financial crisis? Well, in 2008, when the collapse of a global housing bubble triggered the failure of large financial institutions, those rules came under sharp criticism because of the accounting-based minimum capital requirements that regulators impose on those financial services firms. So the fair value rules forced banks to disclose what their key assets were actually worth, and it revealed that regulatory capital was often woefully inadequate for the risks taken. So how did this happen? We'll have a quick look at the main events of the financial meltdown. So in the early to mid 1990s, loans were so easy to obtain and the price of homes increased by 124% between 1997 to 2006. Well, this is not just happening in the United States, even here in Australia and many parts of the world. When the loan was so easy to get, the prices of properties go up because there are many investors who will just borrow from the bank and buy the investment properties. Now, what happens is that the mortgage-backed securities called MBSs and the collateralized debt obligations, the CDOs, greatly increase because of the ability to raise cash very easily. Investors, therefore, put money into these MBSs and CDOs because, well, people are borrowing. There are many people who wanted to borrow. And so those investors who have extra money are able to put their investment into these mortgage-backed securities and collateralized debt obligations. The availability of new forms of mortgaging increased housing demand and of course increased the prices of houses as well. The speculative bubble eventually proved unsustainable. The interest rates edged up in 2007 and mortgage defaults rose, and from 2007 the prices of properties actually started to deteriorate. By the end of 2007, 12% of all US mortgages were either delinquent or in foreclosure. So the major global financial institutions began reporting sizable investment losses. 12% is actually quite a big chunk, and that actually created this domino effect. You notice this is by the end of 2007. Global financial crisis didn't happen until middle to late 2008, but that's a trigger. All right, there are a lot of these what they call ninja loans, no income, no job, and you can still apply for loans because it's so easy to apply for loans. And there are many people who are kind of using these loans to go on holiday, travel around the world, and they thought that they can easily pay it back because prices of properties are going up. But what happens when the prices of these properties begin decreasing or declining? That's when more and more foreclosures happen and delinquency and payments actually increase. So now let's have a look at the tipping point. When it's no longer sustainable, that's when it comes crashing. The tipping point happened in September 2008. This is when the US government took control of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So Fannie Mae is the Federal National Mortgage Association, and Freddie Mac is known as the Federal Home Loan Mortgage Corporation. Two financial institutions that owned or guaranteed about 57% of the $12 trillion of US mortgage market. Lehman Brothers also entered into the largest bankruptcy in the US history. Merrill Lynch was rescued by Bank of America and Goldman Sachs, and Morgan Stanley converted to bank holding companies. Gotta understand, these are the biggest financial institutions in the United States, and they are in big trouble. Washington Mutual was seized by the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC, and Wachovia agreed to be acquired by Citigroup. Now, Wachovia is the nation's fourth largest bank at that time. So you can see the enormity of the impact of the financial crisis. Banks could no longer raise the cash needed to sustain operations or to satisfy the regulatory capital requirements. So this is the kind of the history that took place during this critical period. In October 2008, Emergency Economic Stabilization Act of 2008 was introduced. Then in December 2008, SEC concludes that the mark-to-market rules should not be suspended. In January 2009, FASB issues fair value accounting study. This is why we are discussing fair value in the context of the financial crisis. And in February 2009, 31 financial service firms form Fair Value Coalition. By March 2009, the legislation is introduced to broaden the oversight of the FASB to four other agencies. And in April 2009, FASB eases some rules, but fair value accounting remains intact. So in 2011, the FASB and the IASB, the International Accounting Standards Board, completed a joint project intended to ensure that fair value has the same meaning under US GAAP and under IFRS, and that GAAP and IFRS guidance on fair value measurement should be the same or in sync. In order to extend the scope of fair value accounting, FASB issued ASU 2016-01 in January 2016. As a result, minority passive equity investments, which is generally less than 20% ownership, are now required to be measured at fair value with changes in fair value recognized in net income, unless there is no readily determinable fair value. The impairment assessment of equity investments without readily determinable fair values was simplified, and an entity applying the fair value option to its own liabilities is now required to recognize in other comprehensive income, not net income, the change in fair value attributable to the entity's creditworthiness. All right. Well, we have covered quite a lot of discussions in this topic. Let's apply it this time. In exercise 8-10, we are applying learning objective 1. So here we are told this scenario. Suppose you and two friends each invested $100,000 in an oil and gas partnership. So three of you invested $100,000 each. So you have invested $300,000 altogether. The general partner is Huge Gamble, and Huge Gamble invests no cash but makes all operating decisions for the partnership, including where and how deep to drill for oil. Drilling costs plus a management fee are charged against the $300,000 of cash that you and your friends invested. So if oil is found, you each get 15% of partnership net income. So 15% times 3, that's 45%. Who gets the bigger chunk, the 55%? It goes to Huge Gamble if oil is found. But if there's no oil found, the well is dry, you get nothing except any cash that remains. We are asked here, what is an agency relationship and what are agency costs? How do these concepts apply to your investment in the oil and gas partnership? All right, so let's first define what an agency relationship is. So an agency relationship occurs whenever someone hires another person, which we will call the agent, to act on that person's behalf, which is the principal. Agency relationship is therefore defined as a formal or informal contract between the principal and the agent to perform some service on behalf of the principal. So who is making the decision on behalf of the principal? It's the agent, because the principal has delegated the decision making to the agent. Now, what are the agency costs? Well, these are what the principals pay in terms of reduced wealth or reduced utility when they delegate their decision making to the agent. So an example is the expected value of profits that is lost to the owners if, for example, the owners set up a cafe business and they appointed the manager. If the manager closed the cafe for lunch of 3 hours instead of just half an hour, then the lost profit will be an example of an agency cost. Now, how do these concepts apply to your investment in the oil and gas partnership? So in this partnership, the general partner, Huge Gamble, who is the agent, makes all the operating decisions. You and your friends are the principals. So there is an agency conflict here because Huge Gamble gets paid regardless of whether oil and gas are discovered. But the investors, you and your friends, will win only if petroleum deposits are discovered. Now, according to the management contract, Huge Gamble is reimbursed for all operating costs and receives a bigger chunk of the profit, 55%, when there is oil and gas found. So this contract structure encourages Huge Gamble to overspend by taking risky bets on exploration because he's got nothing to lose, really. Very little downside risk as far as Huge Gamble is concerned. All costs are reimbursed, and there is a big upside potential if oil and gas are discovered. So this tendency to overspend is a cost of this agency relationship. All right, let's look at exercise 8-A. In 20X1, Illinois Power and Heat spent $5 million repairing one of its electrical generating stations that was damaged by a tornado. The loss was uninsured. Management has asked the Public Service Commission for approval to treat the $5 million as an asset for rate-making purposes rather than as an allowed expense. So we are provided with additional information. So the first requirement and the second requirement ask us what difference will the commission's decision make to the allowed rate in 20X1 and in 20X2. So let's have a look at that. Now remember that the allowed revenue should be equal to operating cost plus depreciation plus taxes plus ROA times the asset base. And also that rate is calculated by dividing the allowed revenue by the estimated total kilowatt hours. All right, so let's start with answering 20X1. We have two columns, expense or capitalized. And in 20X2, also the same, expense or capitalized. So how much is our allowed operating cost? $600 million is given here. What happens if the $5 million repair is allowed as an expense? In 20X1, we'll have to add that to the $600, and so that would be $605. If it is expense, it will not be capitalized, and so allowed operating cost will be $600 still. Now let's look for the assets in service at the beginning of the year. That's $1,600 million. If we capitalize the repairs pertaining to the tornado damage, then we have to add the $5 million to the column on capitalized. So $1,605 million will be capitalized. And so to calculate the allowed return on assets for 20X1 expense, it will just be $1,600 million times the ROA that is allowed of 8%. So that should give us $128 million. Under the capitalized, we have $1,605 times 8%. That would give us $128.4. So now we can calculate the revenue requirement. This is simply the sum of the allowed operating costs with or without the tornado damage and the allowed returns. So 605 under the expense column plus the 128 will give us 733. Under the capitalized column is 600 plus 128.4, so that's 728.4. Now, to calculate the rate, remember the rate is allowed revenue divided by the estimated total kilowatt hours. So the allowed revenue of 733 will be divided by 14,000 million kilowatt hours, and that would give us the rate allowed per kilowatt hour. If this repair is expensed out, it will be 0.05236. But if it is capitalized, it will be 728.4 divided by 14,000. So that's 0.05203. So in 20X2, we will again have expense and capitalize. If we have expensed the repair of 5 million, our allowed operating cost in 20X2 will still be 600 million. If it's capitalized, it says here that we are allowed to depreciate the capitalized cost over 5 years, straight line method. So 5 million divided by 5 years will give us 1 million for every year from 20X2, 20X3, 20X4, 20X5, and 20X6. So we will have 601 million as the allowed operating cost in 20X2. The asset in service is still 1,600 for both expense and capitalized, and then we'll add the remaining book value of the repairs that hasn't been depreciated yet. All right, so that's 1,604 under capitalized and 1,600 under expense. We'll then multiply that by 8%, so we get 128 for expense column, and for capitalized column, it's 1,604 times 8%, so that's 128.32 million. So then again, we'll just add 601 plus 128.32 will give us 729.32, and then we'll divide that by the kilowatt hours of 14,000, we'll get 0.05209. for capitalized. For expense, it's just 728 divided by 14,000, so that is 0.052. So what can we surmise from here? In 20X1, treating the repairs as an expense results in the higher rate. However, the full cost of the damage is recovered in that year with no additional return related to it. In other words, if the demand estimate is achieved exactly, customers pay an additional 5 million in the aggregate in 20X1 itself, exactly offsetting the cost of the damage. In 20X2 and subsequent years until the capitalized tornado damage is fully amortized, the capitalization results in the higher rate. In each year, 20X2 to 20X6, 1/5 of the tornado damage is recovered, so that by the end of the 5 years, the entire 5 million loss would have been recovered. In addition, the rate allows for an 8% return each year on the beginning unamortized cost. So which do you think of these two methods will be favored by the utility company? Of course, it would be the capitalizing option that Illinois Power would prefer. Now we have come to the last illustrative example, and this is P8-2 on Krispy Kreme's compensation recovery plan. We are told that a feature of top executive pay at Krispy Kreme Donuts was its compensation recovery policy. The policy allows Krispy Kreme to take back annual or long-term incentive compensation paid to executive officers and certain other management teams in the event they are later found to have engaged in conduct detrimental to the company. Three types of misconduct are specified. The first one, financial accounting or reporting violations, whether from gross negligence or willful misconduct, that trigger a restatement of previously issued financial statements. Second, business actions that result in a material negative revision of a financial or operating measure that was the basis for incentive awards already paid. And third, any fraud, theft, and similar acts. The executive may be required to reimburse the company for all or a portion of any incentive compensation, including equity-based awards. So these are stock options and stocks. They will have to return it as well if these were paid out during the previous 36 months, as well as any profits realized from the sale of Krispy Kreme stock during that same period. So the first requirement asks us to briefly explain how a typical annual and long-term management compensation plan tied to financial accounting numbers may contribute to agency problems within the firm. Any annual or long-term compensation plans can contribute to agency problems by encouraging managers to take actions that enhance their pay and thus their personal wealth, which at times could be to the detriment of shareholders. Now, these actions may involve real transactions such as opening new stores even in unprofitable locations or channel staffing. I'll talk about channel staffing a little bit later. Now, the actions may also involve financial accounting decisions such as premature revenue recognition or delayed expense recognition. Now, Krispy Kreme's compensation recovery plan, which is similar to the recovery plans adopted recently by a number of U.S. companies, is focused on actions that are detrimental to shareholders that later trigger an accounting restatement. Let's go to requirement two. We are asked to provide examples of the accounting abuses that Krispy Kreme's pay recovery policy is intended to discourage. So here are two examples. The first one is actually what we refer to as channel stuffing. So what that means is overstating revenue by forcing, for example, the retail franchisees of Krispy Kreme to purchase donut mix and supplies before the items are actually needed. So this is what we refer to as stuffing the different channels. In this case, the channels for Krispy Kreme would be the franchisees, because a lot of the retail stores of Krispy Kreme may be owned by the company, but others will actually be owned by the franchisees. So by forcing the owners of those franchises to buy the raw materials from them, they're able to inflate their revenue whilst stuffing the other channels. Another example could be understating expenses for the quarter by recording certain operating costs as part of new store acquisitions. So the new store acquisition cost will be capitalized, and therefore this will not be recorded as operating costs. So some managers might consider operating costs as part of new store acquisition costs. Both of these examples are taken from the company's description of the accounting abuses that led to its restatement. So now let's go to the third requirement. Explain why you do or do not believe the pay recovery policy will be effective in discouraging those accounting abuses. Well, the pay recovery plan is really aimed at reducing managers' incentives to inflate reported financial statement results and thus their annual and or long-term compensation awards. So this formal requirement to pay any ill-gotten gains should discourage accounting abuses. Well, that is it for topic 7. I'd like to close with this Bible quote from the mouth of Jesus himself. He said in Mark 14 verse 38, "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." And this quote is actually very catchy. It says, "When you flee temptations, don't leave a forwarding address." Let's close with a word of prayer. Our gracious Father in heaven, we are so grateful that we have completed yet another topic. And we pray, Father, that we'll be able to apply what we have learned, not only in our academic life or in our career, but more importantly, we pray that we will always remember to watch and pray, to surrender all to you, so that if ever we are tempted, we will look to you for a way out. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't forget your post-lecture required activities, and I will see you in class. Bye for now.